Hello everyone, my name is Daniel Pye and welcome to my YouTube channel. My goal is to help as many martial artists as possible in their journey and study of Jiu-Jitsu, whether you are a complete beginner or an experienced martial artist. I do videos every Friday, so if you like and enjoy this video, don't forget to subscribe to get more just like it. This video is going to be the third part looking at the sequence in Pinan Sandan, notoriously known as the hands and hips bit. So looking at just the applications of that. So we've looked at some techniques where we've done like neck controls, head cranks, and we've looked at some throwing techniques. Principal bit that I would say that all bunkai for this kata have in common is that Pinan Sandan is very much a very close range kata. It involves a lot of moves that are more akin to grappling and short range techniques. So we're going to look at that this week, and we're going to look at some striking techniques, and we're going to look at the sort of the slightly ridiculous striking techniques that you also sometimes see, and sort of look at how we can sort of curve that circle, so to speak. So if you like and enjoy this video, don't forget to subscribe and like it and put some comments down below and let us know your thoughts. Okay. So if we start with the most ridiculous application you will ever see is this part of the kata. So if Mike goes left leg forward and he's going to step forward and do a nice straight punch, because all the attacks are like that, of course. And so I'm in this position, and what you get is as his punch comes, I'm going to step, and I'm going to block across, and I'm going to hit, and I'm going to do it like the kata does. If I can do that, I'm fighting the world's nicest attacker ever. So I'm never going to be able to do that. Another nice one, this is my personal favourite, is this technique is an application for when your hands are in your pockets. So if the punch comes, you're going to, you know, all of a sudden, you're just going to defend like that. So by the time somebody's just going to land on the attack, my hands really shouldn't be in my pockets. So again, quite absurd. But there is a point about the range, and the issue is the fact that when you do those applications, they assume that you start at long range. The other bit of this technique that has merit is the ripple. So the idea that as you do this seeming blocking motion, that you then come straight back into the striking technique. So that kind of ripple is useful. So for example, a punch comes to the head, it could be seen as like racking, coming back and just doing a strike. That's what I mean by the ripple, so you've got this block and then into the strike, okay? So if we do it at close range, so just to say we've got clashed arms, for example, I want, as this pattern gives me lots of techniques that I can do from this position. So we've already seen kind of techniques where we come here, where we take them back and we turn for the throw. So this time, what this allows me to do is, as I step, I can pull the arm and use my body to break the elbow, and then from there, come back and strike. And personal preference on the target, so I can come to the body, I can come to the groin, I can even come up to the head. And then from there, I can just step in knee, I can carry on, and I can come back to the other techniques we did before. So I'm again, I'm here. So a couple of little things. Number one, the stance also is part of the technique. It's not just a case of I'm just stepping and twisting. So as the technique comes, I'm stepping and breaking his balance. So now his balance is forward. So as I do this, that really jolts the elbow really, really nicely. The other thing is this hand, which is here, is showing the pull, whilst the other one is coming forward to here. Then I've got my back fist. Then you have the kata, you have hammer fist, which works just as nicely. Another option that you can do from here is as you come, is you can use this to trap the other hand and just come over the top. You can then use the leg, you can step with the punch, lots of options. This also works on the inside, so we do it on this side. So we'll start in exactly the same position, but if I ripple and come in here to there, which if I'm at really close range, the hand comes down, is just a nice distraction that we can do. So one, two. What I don't want to do though, when I want to suck on the inside, is stay there. So that's the kind of problem. So what you're better off doing is coming back to the outside, which is why you have the sort of movement stepping from one side to the other. And another option that we can do, go back to this, like I said before, is we can link this and come through for the next technique back to where we were before, come for the neck crank, and we can also take the arm across. So we have a nice control, because that's again what I said before, kata for me is about close range techniques. So I want techniques that just allow me to control my opponent and just get a good solid grip. And then my takedowns can be crude. So as we do a step forward and punch, I can just step and use that stepping motion just to knock balance. One more time. So one, two, coming in and then step. And I'm obviously letting go to be nice, but you can keep the choke on if you wish. So think of that idea of the ripple. If it is like a punching technique that comes, then as you're doing it, either on the inside or the outside, you can think of blocking either this way or this way, depending on the height of the technique, and just rip them straight off. There's a nice fast technique, which is something that you think more about sparring. But at close range, what you're more likely to think about is the action of coming right across. That's why there's so much emphasis placed on this. One other thing just to finally think about is in the shoulder cam version of this movement, quite often the leg is lifted up and comes down. So we kind of talked about that before, but just to put that into context. So we've said that from here, we can think one, two, and we can think here with the leg. Well, I've also got the option, as I come in, of one, and just stepping just into the leg as I pull the arm. So I can do the two together. I can do that on the inside and the outside. And in fact, on the inside, if I do get stuck in this position, that motion is a particularly nice way of getting out of it. Very simple, very crude, but works quite nicely. So that's just looking at some striking techniques that you can do. Think of that ripple. You need some degree of speed. It shouldn't be done staccato and it shouldn't be done slowly. But you think about your starting range. You can vary the attacking position that you start from, and if you're sort of trying to put all of those bits we've talked about together, just think about varying and mixing them up at close range. Don't necessarily start too far away, because that's not really how the kata is intended. Start closer, link them together, and again, go back to the techniques we did in videos 1 and 2 and see how you can link that through to what we've covered in this video. I hope you enjoyed the video, guys. I hope it gave you something to think about, hopefully inspired you in some way. If it did, don't forget to put a comment down below. And if you want to check out more of our videos, you can click the links in here, 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 or clicking the subscribe button there. And if you've got any ideas for videos you'd like to see, again, don't forget to put those in the comments below. I will do my best. See you next week, guys.